Compute. OK. So, let us restart from where we stopped last week. Let me rechange the sound, OK. So last week, we stated, so we are in the section where we are talking about nilpotent hypergroup. And so last week, so we provided several results regarding nilpotent C class, regarding perp adjoint subhypergroup commutator, etc. And we finished by this this inclusion we want to prove now. Okay, so let me refresh very briefly the definition of all this symbol. What is that? What is that? What is that? Just in few line, in very few lines, just to refresh quickly. So recall. S-perp is the set of linear characters such that the value of this linear character on an element of the set S is the Frobenius-Perron dimension of S. So for all S in S, this is S-perp. S is the set of standard elements such that the multiplication with its dual is in S. And finally, S adjoint is the subbasis generated by, that's why I write like that, the element there such that the standard element such that there are less than y star for some y in S. Not for all, of course, for some. It is the subbasis generated by, so the subhypergroup generated by. Okay. Here, we already know it's a subbasis here, so the basis of a subhypergroup. But here we should take the generated like that. Okay, so with that, it will not be complicated to prove this inclusion. So this is what we will do. We will prove this inclusion now. Okay. So, so proof. Okay, so we will take an element here and we will show it is here. So it reduces show that mu j multiplied by mu j dual is in S commutator perp. So remember where should I write here? Yeah. This is what we use for the multiplication on H hat, and this is the involution, the dual on H hat. Okay, so there is nothing new here. So we have to prove that for all. linear character in SPERT. OK. OK. So, yeah. So, because see, if you can prove, so here we are in SPERT. So we take a linear character in SPERT, and then for that, corresponding to that, we consider this. See, it is exactly like here. And because the perp is always a subbasis, we don't need to care about generated by here. We just need to care about this part. So we need this to be here. And be careful here. This is considered as the sub hypergroup, not the subbasis, because it may not be a standard element. So this is again the abuse of notation here. Abuse of notation. Is considered as sub hypergroup here, not the sub basis. Okay, so this is what we have to prove. Okay, so now, okay, so now take. So if we take a standard element in the commutator of S. Standard element. Then by definition of the commutator, X star is in S. Okay, this is exactly the definition we recall here. This is okay. Next, so we have that, and therefore, so wait. Therefore, what do we have? New G dual X is equal to new G X new G X star. So this is just the definition of the from the definition of the dual on the definition of the involution on the dual. So you can put the star here if you like. Then because it's a linear, an algebra map. Because it's an algebra map, you can put everything inside like that. This is for algebra New G is algebra morphism. Okay. And finally, you have, this is equal to the Frobenius-Perron dimension of x squared. And here there are two justifications. So we know that yeah, it's because x star is in S and mu g is in S perp. Okay. And if you like the Frobenius-Perron dimension of x, x star is equal to the Frobenius-Perron dimension of x squared, because the Frobenius-Perron dimension is invariant by the dual. Okay, so we have that. Okay. So now we want to connect with that. But we are almost done here because, in fact, the multiplication is related to this. In fact, we have to be careful because the multiplication is defined on normalized. You need the normalized standard basis. So this is what we want to explain now. This implies so mu g multiplication mu g involution, but on the normalized, defined on the normalized. So by definition, we know from, I guess we wrote that in the introduction, definition of multiplication, this multiplication, and be careful. It should be on normalized standard basis. A source of mistake. So by definition, it is like that. Mu g x divided by Frobenius-Perron dimension of x multiply mu g involution x divided by Frobenius-Perron dimension of x. Okay. So it is equal to so 1 over the Frobenius-Perron dimension because it's linear square mu g x mu g involution x, but we already know by album here this is equal is the same, so we it's equal to that, so it's equal to that, so we get we got 1, so it's equal to 1. Okay. Wait a minute. So wait, ta 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 ta. It's okay. This is useless here. Let me check. So we have this is the square. It's okay. It's okay. Now, yeah. So it's equal to 1, and so this one is equal to this is equal to the Frobenius-Perron dimension of x divided by the Frobenius-Perron dimension of x, because we want to consider the perp. That the perp is related to something should be equal to the Frobenius-Perron dimension. So, because of that, here, because we have this equal to this, where this is in the commutator, it means that this is in the perp of the commutator. Okay, so we get which show mu g multiplied by mu g involution is in the perp of the commutator of S. Okay. So we started from this is what we want to show. Okay. So we started from, we took that. So this is assume. So let me write. So here we need to say so here for all. All mu g in S perp. So just to avoid any confusion, here this is this S perp. We have that. Okay, and so it's true. The conclusion is true for all S for all mu g in S perp. So this is what we wanted to prove, and we are done. So thus, S perp adjoint is included in S co perp. It's okay. What happened? I received so many messages. No, it's okay. It's okay. Okay. So, next proposition. Six. Okay, so now, what is the next proposition about? Okay, so we will connect. So remember, yes, last week we defined the lower central series involving the commutator. And the upper central series involving the adjoint. And in this proposition, we will connect the entry of this series using the perp and the dual. So let H be dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup, dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup. So remember, dualizable means the dual is also abelian real non-negative. So with the above notation for perp and the lower and upper series, with the above notations, for all n greater than or equal to 0. First, nth entry of the upper central series for the dual is included in perp of the nth entry of the lower central series of the hypergroup. And dually, you can get exactly like that. Okay. So, proof. Ah. Okay. So this will be proved by induction. So we first need to show it is true for n equals zero. And in fact, we will prove by induction, but we will see after the proof that in fact it's also so we will get equality for n equals zero. But we will show that we also have equality for n equal one, but we don't care about this proof because in this proof we only need inclusion. But for n equals zero, you have equality and also n equal one. But we will mention n equal one after the proof. So for n equals zero, we have what is that? By definition, it's just the dual of H. But the dual of H is perp of the trivial sub-hypergroup of H. If you take the trivial sub-hypergroup, the perp is everything. Okay. And this is just so C is just the first entry of the lower central series, remember? So we have that, and so we have what we wanted to show for n equals zero, we have equality. So for n equals zero, we have an equality. This equals this for this trivial reason. Okay. Now, you suppose it is true for n, and we will prove it is true for n plus 1. Now, suppose that we have that. Included in HN perp. HN plus 1 equal. So by definition, HN add. So this is just the definition of the upper central series by definition. No problem here. And okay. Then we know by induction hypothesis that it is like we have that inside, and then you repeat add. So this is by induction hypothesis. This is first the induction hypothesis, but it's not enough because you can see the induction hypothesis. Wait. We have to be careful here. Add, we put add, so add is covariant, so it do not reverse the inclusion. Plus the fact that this is covariant. Okay, so this is okay. Then here we will use a lemma we proved last week. So let me check lemma 8.5. Ah, yeah, no, the lemma we just proved just at the beginning of the class. So S-perp add is included in S-co-perp. Here we have something perp add. Here it's perp add, and we can replace it's included in something co-perp. So we are just using this statement we just proved. Yeah, so lemma. It's lemma. Lemma five. It is equal to, so it is included in, we can replace okay. And then again, by definition of the lower central series, it is H n plus 1 perp. By definition. Okay. So we have proved by induction the first and the second, in fact, is the same. Because we are dualizable, so by duality, the second is deduced from the first. So the second inclusion follow by duality. That's okay. And now, as I mentioned, we can show that the equality we have here also hold for n equal 1. But for n greater than 1, it does not hold. Be careful. But exceptionally, it also holds for n equal 1, and it will involve a group-like element. So observe that the equality hold for n equal 1 also so we start from that. By definition, is like that. Okay. And then we use a corollary we proved last week. Corollary 715. And this corollary 715, so let me check. This corollary is made of several equality, and one of this equality is exactly what we need. So H dual add is equal to the perp of the group-like element. So this is equal to the perp of the group-like element, and this is because this is exactly the perp of H1 because H1 is commutator of the trivial. The commutator of the trivial, so when you have the product of two, the product of a standard element and its dual is trivial, mean that it is a group like. So the commutator of C is a group like. So that's why you get this equality. Okay. So we also have the equality. This equality also works for n equal 1, but it does not work in general for n greater than 1. Ok. So now we can prove another theorem stated in the introduction. So theorem 111, I will recall it briefly before proving it. So this theorem, so the statement, let me recall the statement briefly here. Let H realizable abelian pre-annihilative hypergroup. HB is nilpotent if an angle is dual in nilpotent. Dual H hat is also nilpotent. Moreover, they share the same nilpotency class. And in fact, so it's not so surprising because we proved several results regarding the nth entry of the lower or upper class the series for the hypergroup or is dual. So you will see that the proof, in fact, will be very short using what we just proved before. So proof. So the fact that this hypergroup is nilpotent, this fact means that one entry of the upper central series is trivial. Then it will be trivial. After that, it will be constant. Constantly trivial. But we know that the nilpotency can be read in the upper central series or in the lower central series, and in fact, the entry is the same. This is equivalent to this to be to the nth entry of the lower central series to be everything, as we already mentioned last week. As already mentioned, from Gelacky-Nikšić theorem. So we already mentioned that. We said that they stated the theorem for fusion rings, and we said that the proof works as well for hypergroup and dualizable abelian UL-negative hypergroup. So we know that we can read the nilpotency on the lower central series or on the upper central series and at the same entry. Okay, then now if you consider the so now we want to show the dual is also nilpotent. So you consider the nth entry of the upper central series of the dual, and we want to show it is trivial also. So we know it is included in this one. So by the inequality, by something we just proved here. So 8, 4, we have that. So here is just 8 for equation 8, 4. Then, okay, so now we know by assumption that this is, so we know that this equals this, so you can replace this by H. Okay, so this is H perp using this equality here. But H perp is trivial. The perp of everything is trivial. And here I wrote a justification that in fact, if you really want to prove why the only linear character which is equal to the Frobenius power dimension, yeah, in fact, it's yeah, no, it's trivial. There is no, you don't even need a justification here. I was about to write Frobenius Perron theorem, but in fact, you don't even need the Frobenius Perron theorem. I can remove that from my note. This is just saying that so C here mean C FPDIM, and so it mean so the perp wait, so let me say orally because it's straightforward. What is the perp of everything? So the perp of everything is a linear character which is equal to the Frobenius power dimension everywhere. So it is a Frobenius power dimension linear character. There is no choice. Okay. Okay. Being FPDIM everywhere, just mu x equal FPDIM of x for all x in B imply mu equal FP. Okay. So that's okay for that. So we have that the dual is nilpotent, and the class is the same. So nilpotency class is the same because here you can say, okay, the nilpotency class here should be less than or equal to n. But if you apply the same argument to the dual of the dual, you get also it should be greater than or equal to n, so it's equal to n. So therefore, HB is nilpotent. And the converse follow. So if you start from the dual nilpotent, you get that the initial hypergroup is nilpotent. By duality, using the dual version of the equation 8,4, which is equation 8,5. And then you can, and the nilpotency class are the same, it's straightforward. As I explained orally, so there is no problem about that. So we proved this theorem stated in the introduction. So for a dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup, being nilpotent is the same as a dual to be nipotent. Nipotency is invariant by dual. In fact, it's more than that. It's nipotent if only if the dual is nipotent. But if you identify the double dual with the initial hypergroup, you can do because it's abelian. In the abelian case, this is the same to say that the nipotency is invariant by dual. Anyway, so we are done with this subsection. Now we will discuss and prove. Burnside will prove that the nilpotent abelian real non-negative hypergroup are Burnside. Burnside property for nilpotent abelian real non-negative hypergroup. OK. OK, so remember that the Burnside property involves the notion of group-like and vanishing element. Burnside property is saying that group, so what is say? Group-like is equivalent to non-vanishing. Recall what is vanishing. So let H be. Oh, this is almost the time for the poll. B an abelian real non-negative hypergroup. Recall that we call XI, standard element XI, a vanishing element if there is a linear character mu G such mu G XI is equal to 0. OK. And so after the pause, we will prove a lemma involving vanishing element and the quotient of a hypergroup with a sub-hypergroup. So pause. Okay, so Burnside, we recall what is vanishing. Okay, so let me mention now, but I will confirm that on the WeChat group. So the class of tomorrow may be canceled because of some personal problem. We have to be, we have to do something. So I will confirm on the WeChat group, but maybe the class of tomorrow will certainly be canceled and I will be shifted to so this will shift the semester of half a week. It does not matter. So instead of finishing on, I don't know, in 20 December, it will finish on 25 December or something like that. Does not matter. Okay, but I will confirm everything on the WeChat group, so don't worry. Tac, so lemma. So what the lemma, what is the first lemma we will prove about okay, so as I said, this lemma will involve vanishing element and the quotient. So what this lemma is saying exactly? If you have a vanishing element in a quotient, then any representative of this vanishing element in the quotient is vanishing in the whole hypergroup. So that is very use that's very useful. In fact, the notion of vanishing element deal with a quotient. So let this be an abelian real non-negative hypergroup, and you take a sub-hypergroup be a sub-hypergroup then we will consider its quotient. Consider. So we consider a standard element of H, which is vanishing in H quotiented by L. So consider a standard element xi such that in the quotient, so the class of xi in the quotient is a vanishing element in the quotient of H by L. Then xi is also a vanishing element. It's also a vanishing element in HP. Okay. So proof. Okay, so for that, we need to use our model for the quotient. So remember that we mentioned that the quotient is isomorphic to the double dual like that, where lambda s is the central idempotent corresponding to, oh yeah, so here I use a bad notation. If you identify with the basis, you can use S or L as well, it does not matter. Okay. Yeah. So this here I use index S, but I can use index L, it does not matter. Just this is a central idempotent corresponding to the subhypergroup, as we defined several times. So you have this double dual like that. Double dual, no, double coset, sorry, double coset, the double coset model. So as hyper group, and this class maps to lambda s, x lambda s. Okay. Now, if lambda s. So you use, so it's a central idempotent. So it's a sum of primitive central idempotent. And the index s, this index, in fact, this is the index for which we have so the index of the component of the primitive central idempotent and sum. Because it's not everything, some may not be there. You just consider the component here. This corresponds to a component. It decomposes into primitive component. And for the rest, it's zero. So this refer to definition 6.3. OK. Then, so you see what this is meaning. This is meaning that this is the identity on all these components and zero otherwise. Okay? But we know it is So the hypergroup is commutative, and the primitive Sandra eigenmotant is make a basis of this hypergroup. So we directly see something like that. G I S C F G. OK. Is immediate as a sub algebra of H. Okay, next. Yeah, so what is the key idea here is that we are considering. We know the linear character on H, but we want to consider the linear character on the quotient. But in fact, this here, all the linear character regarding this index, in fact, can be restricted to this part and they are all different because in fact this part regards only this component like that, but also the linear character of this index are also non-zero on this part and zero everywhere. So if you have two linear characters with index here, which are different in H, they are different also here. Okay, for immediate reason. Thus, the linear character, which is character because it's abelian, but okay, the linear character mu g characters. Mu g with g in is, this index set a distinct restriction to the double coset. Have distinct restriction to what I call the double coset, but it may not be the official name when you are in the hypergroup. For group, okay, it's double coset, but for hypergroup, I don't know if it is called double coset, but let's call double coset orally just to know what we are referring to. So here the justification, the quick justification is just the primitive centrally idempotent is a dual basis of the linear character. Okay. And so, because we are in abelian case, the number of linear characters is equal to the complex dimension. And so, this restriction covers all the linear characters of the double coset. And so, cover all the characters of lambda s, h lambda s, as I said, because of the complex dimension. Because dimension c of lambda s, H lambda s is the cardinal of the index set IS. Okay, so we have the linear character of the double coset. So we are almost done. And the rest is almost. So now, if this is a vanishing element of The quotient of the double coset is a vanishing. When I say double coset, I should say double coset hypergroup. Okay. Because a double coset, even for a group, it corresponds to one element. You should say double coset hypergroup. Is vanishing element in H like that, then so it means that so if you use the isomorphism of hypergroup, it means that this is a vanishing element of the double coset hypergroup lambda s h lambda s. So by above, and I will explain in a little more details why we can reduce to what we wrote above, we deduce xi is a vanishing element in H. And let me quickly explain why what was written above is enough to get this conclusion. So by above, can be explained, can be developed as follow. So lambda s xi lambda s vanishing, what is the meaning of that? Mean the existence of a linear character of lambda s h lambda s on which lambda s xi lambda s vanish. But so by above, but by what we wrote above, all such linear characters are covered by the restriction of the linear character corresponding to the index set IS. All such linear characters are covered by lambda s restricted that. So there exists a G in lambda s such that mu s lambda s xi lambda s equals 0. Because we assume lambda s xi lambda s is vanishing, so there is a linear character. And we know this linear character comes from a restriction of the linear character of H with index in IS. So this is what we have. But lambda s xi lambda s is the scalar. Scalar at the block FG. So is exactly mu g xi. Okay. Since G is in this index set. So we got the existence of linear character of H for which this vanish. So XI is really a vanishing element of H. Okay. So lemma. So we are done with this lemma. Next lemma. So what the next lemma is talking about? Okay. So the next lemma is something we already mentioned. Maybe I don't know if we proved it in details, but yeah. Remember, it was a lemma 232 saying that the group-like element acts on the standard element. So you take the basis, you take the set of standard elements, and any group-like element act on that. So if you multiply a group-like element by a standard element, it will still be a standard element. Up to a multiplicative constant. And if you restrict to the normalized case, you don't need to consider the multiplicative constant. And so this lemma will explain what kind of multiplicative constant we need to consider. But it's more it's it will be a little bit more precise. But it's more or less just a reformulation of lemma 232, a little bit more precise. So let H be an abelian real non-negative I pair group. So a group like element X I, le groupe like element, is a constituent of, so here it's in fact when I say it's a reformulation of lemma 232, I should say, yeah, it's very similar, so it's the same thing as lemma 232 up to the Frobenius reciprocity. That's why, in fact, the proof will reduce to lemma 232 and the Frobenius reciprocity. So a group-like element is a constituent of a product of a standard element with this dual, if and only if and only if x I x j equal the Frobenius Perron dimension of x I xj. So be careful. In the fusion ring case, the Frobenius Perron dimension of a group-like element is always one. In the hypergroup case, be careful, you need to consider also the constant hi or something like that. So in hypergroup, the Frobenius Perron dimension of a group-like element might not be one, but it will be one if you multiply by the Gauss constant hi or something like that. As we explained in several sections before. Okay, moreover, in fact, here you have a group like is a constituent if only if you have that, and moreover, the set of all the group like elements constituent to that form a subgroup of the group of group like elements. It's a subgroup, and we will need these two statements. Moreover, the set of all group-like elements that are constituent of XGXG dual form a subgroup of the group of group-like elements. It's a subgroup. Okay, so as I said, the proof will need the Frobenius reciprocity. By Frobenius reciprocity. Remember, it was the equation 218. The fusion coefficient Nij k is the fusion. Wait, NIJ. In fact, I don't need K. NIJ. We need restricted Frobenius reciprocity. This is N G G star I. So remember, but you put a star here and you have to transpose these two. But because we are in hypergroup, we need some H I constant. So remember, it's H G H I like that. Okay. Thus, X I is a constituent. Is a constituent of XG XG star if and only if XG is a constituent of XI XG. So this is just a Frobenius reciprocity. Next. Okay, if and only if. If and only if. So it's here we use the lemma. So lemma 232. This lemma is saying that the normalized case, so you have this action on the set of standard elements. Dim of XG is in the set of normalized standard elements. So we get, but we know, so we know that this is a standard element, and we know this is a constituent of that. So we know that this standard element will be exactly that, in fact. There is no choice. If and only if X I, so the if and only if is the sequel of this one. You have if and only if that, and this is a justification of this if and only if. Okay, so if and only if X I divided by Frobenius per dimension of X I time X G divided by Frobenius per dimension of XG is equal to XG divided by Frobenius per dimension of XG. Okay, again, if and only if, and here, so you just simplify the equation. So Frobenius per dimension of XI XG, like that, which is what we wanted to prove. Here. So we got that. And then the fact that we have a subgroup is so this is this is standard, in fact. You can use the standard how to say. Because we are because I will not write any details, but you see here, you have an element which is group-like, you get that. So if you continue to multiply by another element here, you will get the same with Frobenius per dimension, etc. So you will get that at least is a monoid. You can also prove it as an inverse, etc. So you have a monoid. It's a finite monoid. Maybe finite monoid is always a group. Let me see. I guess a finite monoid is always a finite group. A monoid is not always a group, of course, but if you have a finite case, There's always a group, there's a finite group because you, if you iterate, you, yeah. Otherwise, you need to care about the unit, but it's the proof is not so complicated. It's a very, very easy. So the second assertion, second assertion is a straightforward consequence. Consequence of this. And here you use so hint. So you can see that exercise. Hint. Finite monoid is a finite group. If I'm not mistaken, I guess so. Let me see. If I'm not mistaken, if I am not mistaken, it should be true. Or you sh I know there is a result like that. A finite monoid with a unit. Do you need a unit or not? Do you need inverse? Anyway, I guess it's true. I will check. Anyway, so. Okay. Here I put a question mark. I'm not 100% sure, but I will check. Otherwise, the proof, the you can prove all the action of a fine group, it will be very easy also. But I guess because the group is finite. Anyway, so I don't need to say more about that. Proof of one. Okay. So now we can prove another statement written in the introduction. Proof of theorem 112. So let me refresh your memory about the statement of theorem 112. It's the following: a nilpotent dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup is both Bernside and dual Bernside. A nilpotent dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup is both Bernside and dual Bernside. But we know that by the previous theorem 111 that nilpotent is equivalent to dual nilpotent. So we are reduced to prove that a nilpotent dualizable abelian real non-negative hypergroup is Bernside. Because if it is Bernside, wait, nilpotent equivalent to dual. Yeah, a nilpotent dualizable. If a nilpotent dualizable abelian real negative hypergroup is Bernside, then we know that nilpotent imply The dual is also nilpotent. So then we know the dual is nilpotent. So the dual is also Bernstein. So the initial is a dual Bernstein. Okay. So by theorem 111. But wait. I will not recall. So remember that this theorem is saying HB nilpotent under the good assumption is equivalent to the dual is nilpotent. So by this theorem, it is enough to prove the following proposition: Bernstein, a nilpotent imply Bernstein. By this theorem, it is enough prove that nilpotent implies Bernstein in the good under the good assumption, and the good assumption are dualizable abelian UL non negative. It's equivalent to prove that nilpotent dualizable abélien réel non négatif hypergroup HP Bernstein. It's enough to prove that, and then we get the theorem 112. Okay. So this theorem, the proof of this theorem is a little bit long. In fact, it is 2 pages on my note, so we will definitely not have time to finish the proof today. The proof will be next time, and I repeat, next time may not be tomorrow, but I will confirm later. So proof. We will proceed. So the proof will be by induction on the nilpotency class. You know it is the hypergroup is nilpotent. So, but it can be nilpotent with nilpotency class 0, 1, 2, 3. In fact, 0, or the class 1, I say 1, is completely trivial. Because being nilpotent of nilpotency class 1 is equivalent to be pointed, or to be everything is a group-like. But remember that the Bernstein property is a property involving group-like is equivalent, not group-like is equivalent to vanishing. But if you have nothing, if everything is group-like, and we know that group-like cannot be vanishing because it involves root of unity, because in particular the, for example, the entry of the character table of an abelian group is always the root of unity. And here, if you have a group-like element, then the value of the linear character on that is always the root of unity, because in group-like you have a power for which it's like a group element. So there is a power for which you reach the one. And so by the algebra morpheme structure of the linear character, you have something power equal one. And so it's a root of unity. So it cannot vanish. So you have the pointed case, you have the Bernstein property automatically. So that's why you have the first step of the induction is immediate, because the first step implied is a pointed case. So I will write that. So we will proceed by induction the nilpotency class of HB. The class is one, if the nilpotency class, if HB is of nilpotency class one. Then so what is it? Be up. No. What I wanted to write here, Nipotassi class one. So what should we so should we use am I use so wait, am I using the lower central series or the upper central series? Let me check something. So wait a minute. So 8, 9. Oh, there is no details. Okay. Okay, so I guess it's. Ah, okay. This is what we call the commutator. So B commutator. So remember that the nilpotency class can be read in the upper central series or in the lower central series. And the commutator, not up, but commutator. What we call the commutator, this is B1, is a commutator. If the nilpotency class is 1, then B1 is equal to C. Meaning that so what is this meaning? It mean so let me just write it again, but without it, but we already mentioned that. So we have x star is x1 up to constant, up to multiplicative constant. So it means that X is group like. Okay. If you have an element you compose with its dual, if you have only one, so one is the only constituent of that. So it's this is group like, there is no problem. So it means that it's pointed. Oh, this. Okay. Meaning that HB is pointed. All standard element, standard element are group like. No problem. So it's automatically burned side. So and I guess we will just finish the first step of the induction today. Burn side. Burn side. And why? As I said orally. Why it's automatically burn side. Here I will explain in more details. The recall burn side mean the following. A in B not group like if and only if where exists linear character such that mu A, so if and only vanishing. So in other words, burn side mean group like is equivalent to vanishing. So burn side mean bien. So it's okay. So group like is not equivalent to vanishing in general. What when I say in other words is the definition of Burnside is Burnside mean not group like is equivalent to vanishing. Not group Ok. Ok. But so we know that there is no all the elements are group like. So ok. So if so not group like imply vanishing. Ok. So we know there is no all. But all element, all standard element, standard element are group like. So we are reduced to show that group like imply non-vanishing. But, and here you have the root of unity, and we will finish. So I will take one extra minute. And this is because, so group like, so you have, it's like up to a constant, up to a multiplicative constant. You have, group like element, so it's like an element of a group. So if you make the power to its order, it's one. So this implies that mu of a power n is equal to mu of a power n equal to one. So mu of a is a root of unity. So cannot be zero. Because we are in a hypergroup, we have to be careful about the multiplicative constant Hi, but because Hi is not zero, you don't need to care about that. Okay, so it's not vanishing, and this will be so then so next time we will assume that the property hold if the nilpotency class is less than n, and we will show that it also holds when the nilpotency class is n. Okay, so we will finish next time. Okay, so see you next time. So maybe tomorrow, maybe next week. I will confirm soon.